morning to you, all of you. First of all, thank you to all organizers of this conference for giving this opportunity to me. And also, I would like to thank my supervisors, Professor Clemency Montel and Professor Kim Plofke, and also Professor Ramasubramaniam, my colleagues, Mr. Mahesh and Aditya, for helping me. My topic is problems pertaining to the determination of direction, place and time in Sripati Siddhantasekhara. Actually, I'm going to talk about the Triprasnadhikara of Siddhantasekhara, on which I am doing my PhD research. Actually, this is not the part of my research. I am working on some other parts of the Siddhantasekhara, but I am reading the Triprasnadhikara of Siddhantasekhara as well. So the first question arising when you look at the topic, problems pertaining to the determination of direction, place and time, is that why is it important? Actually, if you look at some ancient texts written in Sanskrit, even in Brahmana literature, we can see some instructions to follow some rituals, understanding, knowing some direction and auspicious times and so on. Especially in Shula Sutras and in some Kalpa Sutras, Gruhya Sutra and so on, we can see instructions to follow right direction, auspicious times and so on, especially during when people do rituals and construct some temples, Vedic, Yaga Vedikas and so on. So this is very important, especially for construction of yajnas, temples and performance of Hindu rituals. Some later texts like Shilpa texts, Sanskrit texts on architecture, sculpture and paintings refers to finding direction, especially auspicious time to start some construction works. So we can see everywhere in Sanskrit, almost everywhere in Sanskrit texts, a reference related to direction, place and time. So every Siddhanta text has a chapter called Triprasnadhikara, which is three questions, problems pertaining to determination of direction, place and time. So this is the importance of this chapter. So this is the outline of the talk: introduction, Triprasnadhikara, determination of direction, determination of place. Actually, I haven't mentioned determination of time here because of the time limit, and summary reference. So the Siddhantasekhara text was composed by Sripati. Sripati has written seven works ascribed to Sripati. One is on mathematics, Ganita Tilaka. It's basically based on arithmetic, from addition to Trirashika. Singha Tilaka Suri has written a commentary on Ganita Tilaka. Singhatula Sivuri lived in 13th century. And there are three other works written on astronomy by Sripati, Dhruvamanasa, Siddhantasekhara, and Dhikotidhakarana. And also he has written other three books, Jyotisha Ratnamala, Jataka Paddhati, and Daivaknya Vallabha. All of them are on astrology. Mahadeva, who lived in Maharashtra, has written a commentary on Jyotisha Ratnamala. He was also, he lived in 13th century. So basically, Siddhantasekhara is considered as the magnum opus of Sripati. It includes 20 chapters. Verse-wise, it has 883 verses. So this talk is on Sripati Siddhantasekhara. Actually, we don't know much about Sripati. Of course, it is not a surprise. I mean, it is the case of all mathematicians and texts in ancient India. However, we know a little bit about Sripati. According to Mahadeva's commentary on Jyotish Ratnamala, Sripati is the son of Nagadeva, and it says that he is from Kashyapa Gotra. Dhikotidhakarana, written by Sripati, gives the epoch Shaka 971, which is 1039 CE. And also, some scholars say that the composing time of Sripati Siddhantasekhara is also 1039 CE. Dhruvamanasa was composed in Shaka 978, which is the which is 1056 CE. So, given these years, we can say Sripati lived in 11th century. Jyotisha Ratnamala mentions that Sripati composed Jyotisha Ratnamala living in Rohini Khanda, which is Rohini Kheda in Buldana district in Maharashtra. Actually, Naturam Premi says that Rohini Khanda is the Rohini Kheda in Buldana district in Maharashtra. Sripati is mathematician, astronomer, astrologer. And according to Jataka Paddhati, we know that he had some pupils, because Jataka Paddhati has been composed at the request of his pupils. Scholars says that he has been influenced by the ideas of Brahmagupta and Lalla. This is the quotation from Brahmasputa Siddhanta. Vasanabhashi of Brahmasputa Siddhanta. Actually, this defines what the Triprasnadhyaya is. Trayanan prasnanan dik-desa-kala muttaran yatrabhidhiyate sa Triprasnadhikaraha. It says that wherever the answers to the three questions pertaining to direction, place and time are given, that is the Triprasnadhikara. The chapter in which the methods to find direction, place and time are given, that chapter is called Triprasnadhyaya. Actually, there's another commentary written by Makkibhatta on Siddhantasekhara. Actually, he has written the commentary only the first four chapters of Siddhantasekhara. We have commentary for other chapters as well, but that commentary has been written by Babu Aji Mishra, who edited the Siddhantasekhara. the Triprasnadhikara is the fourth chapter of Siddhantasekhara. So the commentary on Triprasnadhikara has been written by Makkibhatta. Given the Makkibhatta introducing the Triprasnadhikara says that natyakshapakrama vishuvadishta madhyakna chayar kairva dvabhyan chabhyam ekaikasa pruchhayan treha prasnaha sampadyante tesham uttaran yatrabhidhiyate sa Triprasnadhikara iti. The three questions are produced when there is query about each one with respect to those two others by means of the zenith distance, latitude, declination, equinoctial shadow, noon shadow of a desired day or solar altitude. Where the answer to them is given, it is the three questions chapter, Triprasnadhikara. If there are questions about the direction, place and time, which can be asked by means of nati, zenith distance, latitude, declination, equinoctial shadow, the noon shadow of the desired day. So wherever the answers to these questions is given, that chapter is called Siddhantasekhara. So Triprasnadhikara is entirely dedicated to answer the questions for those questions. So the purpose of the Siddhantasekhara, as I already mentioned, is the to explain methods to determining direction, place and time. Actually, the concept that are used to calculate the place and time and find determining direction is gnomon. Gnomon is the stick which is called shanku, and shadow casted by sun and horizon, which is the plane on which observer is going through the center of the sphere, spherical sphere, celestial sphere. Then equator, also ecliptic. Equator is the projection of the terrestrial equator to the celestial sphere. Ecliptic of the ecliptic is the sun's motion during the course of the year. Then meridian, zenith is the uppermost part of the observer's locality. Then to calculate all of them, the knowledge of spherical astronomy, trigonometry, rule of three and similar triangles are required. Some quantities that are usually sought while doing these calculations are time of the day, rising times, right ascension and oblique ascension, ascensional differences, terrestrial latitude, ecliptic ascendant or horoscope point, altitude or direction of the sun, solar declination, and so on. As I mentioned earlier, Triprasnadhikara of Siddhantasekhara is the fourth chapter and also the largest chapter of the text. It includes 124 verses, nearly one-seventh of the text. So now we are moving to the determination of direction. This is the first verse of the Triprasnadhikara of Siddhantasekhara. It reads like, Toya Siddha Vasudha Valayantar Nyasta Lambaka Krutarjava Shankoho Yatra Bhavishati Munchati Vruttang Te Dishau Varuna Vasavayohu Staha. So it gives directions to how to find the east-west directions. So first thing one has to do is that make the surface flat, and also placed the draw a circle on the surface. Then, in the middle of the surface, in the middle of the circle, a shanku has to be placed. Then he can find the east-west line. It is very interesting to see here that he gives some directions how to make the surface flat and how to make the shanku, perfect shanku. Toya Siddha Vasudha Valayanta, he says, one has to make the surface ground flatten you with the help of water. Toyena Siddha Vasudha. Actually, even in the commentary, Makibhatta doesn't say anything how to do this, but we can understand one can make a little dam on the surface and fill some water in it. Then he can find measure the level of the water, and if there are some evenness, he can put some mud and make it flat. Doing the same thing again and again, it can be made perfectly flat. Then, once it get right, one has to draw a circle on the surface using a compass. In the previous talk, we saw that karakatakena sadayet, using a compass, one can draw a circle on the surface. Then, in the center, the shanku has to be placed. It says, nyasta lambaha kruta arjava shanko. Shanku should be straight, arjava, without any floats. And lambaha kruta, it should be placed perpendicularly using a plumb line. It should be perpendicular. So, once we set up shanku, he says, yatra bhavishati munchati vruttang te dishau varuna vasavayohu staha. Actually, if we see the diagram here, we can see this is the shanku, this is the spherical celestial sphere, this is horizon, celestial equator, the diurnal circle, diurnal path of the sun. So this is our circle on the surface. So we have placed the shanku here. So this is the sun rising, sun rises here. So east and west point. So in the morning, sun is here, and afternoon, sun is here. Once we set up shanku here, in the morning, sun's shadow, OW, enters to the circle from here. And in the evening, sun's shadow exits the circle here. So he says, yatra bhavishati munchati vruttang te dishau varuna vasavayohu istha. Actually, the order he uses, in which he uses the words yatra bhavishati and munchati varuna vasavayohu, the order is matters here. The place where the shadow enters is Varuna, and exits, the place where the direction from which the shadow exits is the Vasava, which is east. So we can find, now we know the this point and this point, which is entering point and exit point. So he says, once we link these two points, we have east-west line. In the next verse, he says, Chaya nirgamana pravesha samayarka kranti jivantarang shunnang sasravanena lambakarutang syadanguladhyang palang paschadbindu manena ravyayanantaha sanchala yedvyatyas spashta prachyapara tava nayana vashat pragbindu mutsarayet. Actually, we know that sun moves towards north or south each and every moment when it moves along around the observer's locality. So this second verse gives the method to correct this east-west line, because of the sun's motion towards north or south, it is not always parallel to the equator. If it is parallel, we get exact line, exact parallel line to east-west line. But it is when we get this, if the day is not equinox, it is not equinoxial day, this line would not be parallel to this east-west line. So one has to make some little correction to get the exact east-west line. So in the second verse, he says, Chaya nirgamana pravesha samaya arkakranti jivantarang shunyang sasravanena lambakarutang syadhyangulang palang. The declination, the difference of the declinations of the rising, the chaya nirgamana pravesha, the suns, the declination of the suns when the shadows of the sun exits and enters the shadow circle, multiplied by its hypotenuse and divided by the lambaka, which is the nauman cos phi, then he has to get that amount in terms of angulars. Then once he got this value in angulars, he can make little correction to the east-west line. Then this is the exact east-west line. If you look at this diagram, we see this is the celestial equator. It comes right to here. This is the diurnal path of the circle, a diurnal path, diurnal circle of the sun, sun's diurnal circle. If this is equinoxial day, sun rises here and comes along the celestial equator. But this is not the equinoxial day, so sun rises here and come to the meridian. It always moves towards north or south. So according to this diagram, we see in the morning sun is here. It casts shadow on the circumference of this circle here. If this sun's diurnal circle is parallel to the celestial equator, this red circle should be the diurnal path of the sun's diurnal path. But because of this Uttarayana and sun moves to the northward, now sun comes along this circle. It comes a little bit northwards. So it casts the shadow now here on this circle. But it is, if it is parallel, the shadow will be here, which gives the parallel line to the east-west line, the exact east-west line. But if we link the two shadow points, what we have now, we can see this blue line is the east-west line that we have now. So we have to find this difference, the difference between, suppose this is the exact east-west line, so difference between the, this line, the line point from here to this exact line and from here to this exact line. So once we get the difference of them, we can make from here to here, we can adjust this line to this point, then this will be parallel to the east-west line. So that's why he says one has to get the difference of declinations in terms of angular, because we calculate the shadow gnomon in angulars. So once we get the this value in angulars, we can make the changes. So this change should be we can make perpendicularly northwards. Then in the next lines he says, paschat bindu manena ravyanataha sanchalayet vyatayat spashta prachyaparat varnayana vashat pragbindu musarayet. So once we get the value in terms of angulars, but the next problem is in which direction we have to do the corrections. So the next line says, paschat bindum anena ravi ayanataha vyatteya sanchalet. This correction should be done based on the according to the sun's ayana. If sun moves northwards, the correction should be this point, the east-west line, the it says paschat bindu, the west point should be taken to the north, to the north. If sun moves southernwards, if sun is in the dakshinayana, the point should be taken to south. On the other hand, spashta prachyaparatavah ayanavashat pragbindun utsaret. On the other hand, one can move the other point, pragbindun, in reverse order. If we take the western point to north, when we take east point, it should be southward. That's what he says in the last line. So actually we can prove this using spherical trigonometry. In this diagram, this is the zenith, this horizon, and as we already know, this is sun in the morning and sun in the afternoon. So we know this is the declination of the sun, delta. So from P to this point, it should be 19 sine, R sine. So this P to A2, 9 minus delta. So we know this is phi. So this is from P is a, P is 9 minus phi. So this is zenith distance a from A to Z, and this is azimuth P Z A2 is the azimuth. So this is afternoon azimuth. If we take the PZA1, we have other azimuth A prime. So using cosine formula, we can find the sine delta. So cos 9 minus delta is equal to cos 9 minus phi times cos z plus sine 9 minus phi sine cos sine z cos a. So doing some algebraic manipulation, we can find the answer to sine delta and sine delta 1 and sine delta 2. So subtracting one from the other based on what we have got as the values, we can find this answer, cos phi sine z cos a minus cos a prime. So in the verse he says, then one has to multiply this difference by its hypotenuse, then divide by the Lambaka, which is cos phi. He ends up with the difference in angulars. This difference should be added to the east-west line. Let us see determining north-south line. In the fourth verse, he says, without calculating, one can find north-south line using this method. Chayatrayagrod bhava matse yugmas prukh sutra yoryat yutih pradeshe yamyottara shanku dishoho kakupsa krameyana saumye taragola yoho syat. In this verse, he says, basically, without drawing a circle on the flat surface, what one has to do is just place a shanku in here somewhere on the ground and choose any three points of the shadow. Actually, he doesn't say anything. Find 2 points in the morning and 1 point in the afternoon. He doesn't say anything about that. But to use this method, we cannot choose all 3 points in the evening or in the afternoon. So it is better to find 2 points in the evening or afternoon and one in the evening or afternoon, like that. So one has to find choose three shadow tips of the gnomon. Then he says, draw three equal circles, taking these points as the center of those circles, so that those circles intersect each other. So once we did this, we have two mean the fish fingers. Actually, he says in the verse, matsa yugma spruk sutra yor yatte yutihi pradeshi. Matsa yugma means these fish figures. Then once we have these fish figures, we see there are intersections. So we have to link and extend these lines, then so that these two lines intersects in somewhere. So once we did this, we get this intersection. So then he says, link this link and shanku and draw a line here. It will be the north-south line. That's how he explains how to determine north-south line. He says, Samyottara Shankudishoho Kakupsa Kramena Saumyatara Golayoho Syat. So, the intersection will be north or south depending on the depending on where we are. Suppose sun is in this half, the intersection will be on south. If sun is here, intersection will be in north. So actually this is determination of place. Naraprabha Sangunite Trijive Putaksa Karnena Hrute Paleye Te Shanku Drugye Palabhut Bhavetu Lambaksa Jive Bhavataha Sodeshi. In this verse he says how to find the latitude and co-latitude and also altitude and zenith distance, Shankudrugje and Lambaksha Jive. Actually, here he Sripati deals with two different cases. One is general case, the other is a special case. If this calculation is done on the equinoctial day, we get these values, the second values. He says, Nara, the gnomon multiplied by Trijiva, R divided by Swakarna, its hypotenuse, we have R cos phi, which is the co-latitude. Palabha, the equinoctial shadow multiplied by Trijiva, R divided by Swakarna, we have Akshajiva, which is R sin phi, the latitude. Except the equinoctial day, if we do the same thing in other days, we have general case here. Nara multiplied by Nara is the gnomon, cos phi multiplied by R divided by Swakarna, hypotenuse. It is the Sanku, which is the R sign of altitude. Prabha, the shadow multiplied by Trijiva divided by Swakarna. It is the Drugjiva, which is R sign of zenith distance. So this refers to the determination of place. So given these methods given in the Triprasnadhikara of Siddhantasekhara, we can say Sripati Siddhantasekhara basically provides methods that are already given in the Siddhanta texts for determining direction, place and time. But he seems to have given some more details which are helpful to understand almost the exact way of performance they might have done. Actually, if we go further into the Triprasnadhyaya, we can say lots of alternative methods given by Sripati to determining place, time for the same things. It seems that he prefers alternative methods which are helpful in solving problems efficiently and in simplifying the problems to what are already known. Given all of them, it is fair to say that the main focus might have been utilization of astronomical mathematics. These are some of the references. Thank you.